मॉर्निंग गर्ल्स, नाउ वंस अगेन कम बैक टू द नेक्स्ट क्लास. सो टुडे वी गॉट अ वेरी 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 इम्पोर्टेंट टॉपिक, अ वेरी इम्पोर्टेंट क्वेश्चन फॉर 4 मार्क्स. एंड द क्वेश्चन विल बी नाउ इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड ऑन द इक्वेटोरियल लाइन ऑफ एन इलेक्ट्रिक डाइपोल, और द नेम of the topic will be now electric field on the equatorial line of an electric dipole. So already I told you, now the electric field on the axial line of an electric dipole, now that is also a very very important question for 4 marks. Now another important question we got for 4 marks will be electric field on the equatorial line of an electric dipole. So a very 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 important question for 4 marks. So now let us try to understand now what is the meaning of that. So now once again, now what do you do now? Consider the electric dipole. So you already know the electric dipole will be consisting of a negative charge and a positive charge, and the separation between them will be 2A. So now we are trying to find now what will be the electric field on the equatorial line of that dipole, or now we are trying to obtain now what will be the expression for the electric field on the equatorial line of the electric dipole. Now for that, now what I am doing, now listen very carefully. So what I am doing, now on the equatorial line I'm taking a point P, and at point P I'm keeping a unit positive charge. So remember, in order to obtain the electric field on the equatorial line, now what I am doing, I'm taking a point P on the equatorial line and I'm keeping a unit positive charge at the point P. And one more thing, now remember, now the distance of the point P from the center of the dipole will be small d. Or remember, now the distance of the point P from the center of the electric dipole will be small d. So one thing will be very very clear. So in order to obtain the electric field on the equatorial line, now what I need to do, so I'm keeping a unit positive charge at point P, and the distance of the point P from the center of the dipole will be small d. Now let us see, now what will happen to the unit positive charge, or let us see now what is going to happen to the unit positive charge now due to the two charges of the electric dipole. Now very simple, now what will happen if you take the negative charge now due to, this one as F1 and this one will be F2. So now if you take the negative charge, you can clearly see now due to the negative charge of the electric dipole, the unit positive charge or the unit positive charge will be strongly attracted. So remember, now due to the negative charge of the electric dipole, the unit positive charge will be strongly attracted. Now let us say the attractive force will be denoted by the letter F1, or F1 will be denoting the electrostatic force. Now with which the unit positive charge, will be attracted towards the negative charge. Now similarly, what will happen? Now due to positive charge, the unit charge will be strongly repelled, or the unit charge will be strongly repelled. Now let us say the repulsive force will be denoted by the letter F2, or the repulsive force will be denoted by a letter F2. So one thing will be very clear. Now remember, what will happen to the unit of positive charge? Now due to the negative charge of that dipole, now once again remember, the unit positive charge will be strongly attracted. Now due to the negative charge, that's the reason why the attractive force F1 will be acting in this direction. Now similarly, what will happen? Now due to positive charge of the electric dipole, the unit charge will be strongly repelled. So the unit positive charge will be strongly repelled. Now let us say the repulsive force will be denoted by a letter F2, or the repulsive force will be denoted by a letter F2. So now first you find out what will be the magnitude of F1 and what will be the magnitude of F2. So now for that, if you look at the diagram, now we are getting two triangles, and remember, now both the triangles are identical, why? Because now you already know, this will be the adjacent, and this will be the hypotenuse. So opposite will be D, adjacent will be A. So hypotenuse of the triangle will be under root of D square plus A square. Now similarly, for the other triangle also, this will be adjacent, and this will be the hypotenuse. So opposite will be D, adjacent will be A. So the hypotenuse of that triangle will be under root of D square plus A square. So that is the reason why now both the triangles are identical triangles, or both the triangles will be identical triangles. So now that is the reason why, now what I am doing, now I am assuming, now let this angle be theta, then this angle will be theta. Now you already know this angle will be 90 degree. So the remaining angle will be 90 minus theta. So you concentrate on the first angle. So in the first angle, now this angle will be theta. So this angle will be 90 degree. So the remaining angle will be 90 minus theta. Now similarly for the second angle, now this angle will also be theta. So this angle will be 90 degree. So the remaining angle will also be not 90 minus theta. So now first of all, now what you do, now first you find out now what will be the magnitude of F1, then you find now what will be the magnitude of F2. So first let us find out now what will be the magnitude of F1, and then we are going to find now what will be the magnitude of F2. So first you find the magnitude of F1. Now that will be the attractive force between the unit charge and the negative charge. So you already know from the Coulomb's law, now the magnitude of F1 will be given by the formula. So we got now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, you remember it, now Q1, Q2, now divided by V square. So Q1 will be the magnitude of minus Q. So the magnitude of so 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. So the electrostatic force will be given by now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, now Q1, Q2, now divided by V square. So remember, now Q1 will be the magnitude of the negative charge, and the magnitude of the negative charge will be Q, now multiplied by, now Q2 will be the unit positive charge. And what is the separation between them? The separation between them will be under root of E square plus A square, or the separation between them will be under root of E square plus A square. So remember, now what I am doing, I am calculating the magnitude of the attractive force F1. So F1 will be the attractive force between the negative charge and the unit charge, and both of them, they are separated by a distance, now under root of E square plus A square. So apply the Coulomb's law. So according to Coulomb's law, the electrostatic force, or the magnitude of the electrostatic force, will be given by now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1, Q2, now divided by D square. Now what will be Q1? Now Q1 will be the magnitude of the negative charge, and the magnitude of the negative charge will always be positive. Now Q2 will be the magnitude of the unit positive charge, and the separation between them will be under root of E square plus a square. So I can write, so magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now q into 1 now divided by now d square under root of d square plus a square whole square. Now that is the reason why the magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now q are divided by now d square plus a square. Now let us call it now equation number 1. Now similarly, now what do you do? Now find the magnitude of F2 or find the magnitude of the repulsive force between the positive charge and the unit charge, and both of them they are separated by a distance now under root of d square plus a square. So therefore now I can write now magnitude of F2 will also be equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now multiplied by now q into 1 now divided by now under root of d square plus a square whole square. So therefore the magnitude of F2 will be numerically equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now q divided by now d square plus a square. Now let us call it now equation number 2. So remember here, now we already got the magnitude of F1. Now we already got the magnitude of F1. We also got the magnitude of F2. And if you look at the formula, now the magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to the magnitude of F2. So now remember, by looking at the formula, now it is very clear the magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to the magnitude of F2. So remember, now even though now both the forces will be acting in the different directions, or even though now both the forces will be acting in the different directions, but remember the magnitudes of both the forces are equal. That's the reason why now the magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to the magnitude of F2. So therefore now what I can write, so now what I can write from equation 1 and 2, so I can say now let magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to the magnitude of F2, that will be equal to F. So now I'm supposing, now since the magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to the magnitude of F2, that's the reason why I can write now F1 will be numerically equal to F2 will be numerically equal to F. So remember, now we already got the magnitude of any one of the force. So I will write down, so F will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now q divided by now d square plus a square. Now I'm writing aside so that I can remember for the remaining or derivation. So one thing will be very clear. So the magnitude of F1 will be numerically equal to the magnitude of F2. Now that will be numerically equal to F. So now, we already got the magnitude. So now, what we need to do? So now, we need to find. So now, we need to find. Now, what will be the resultant force of F1 and F2? Or now remember, we need to find. Now what will be the net force that will be acting on the unit positive charge? Or remember, so now we need to find. Now what will be the resultant force that will be acting on the unit positive charge? And remember, now how to obtain the resultant force? Now the resultant force will be given by the parallelogram law of vectors. Now let us see now how to get it. Now remember, now we are going to find now what will be the resultant of F1 and F2. Or now we are going to find now what will be the resultant force that will be acting on the unit positive charge, or what will be the resultant of the forces now F1 and F2. So you already know now the resultant of F1 and F2 will be given by the parallelogram law. So according to that, now the resultant will be given by the diagonal of the parallelogram now drawn from the same point. So remember, now F1 will be acting in the downward direction and F2 will be acting in the upward direction. So F1 will be acting downward and F2 will be acting upward. So remember, now both of them, they are inclined to certain angle. And remember, now the resultant of F1 and F2 will be given by the parallelogram law of vectors. So according to which, the resultant will be given by the diagonal of the parallelogram now drawn from the same point. So now, first of all, now we need to find now what will be the angle between F1 and F2, or what will be the total angle between F1 and F2. So if you look at the diagram, now it is very clear. Now when this angle will be 90 minus theta, or when this angle will be 90 minus theta, so the alternate of this, so this angle will also be 90 minus theta. That is the reason why the remaining angle will be theta. So listen carefully. So if you look at the diagram, then this angle will be 90 minus theta, then the alternate angle will also be 90 minus theta, so the remaining angle will be theta. Now similarly, if you look at F1, now you already know, now F1 will be lying in the third quadrant, or F1 will be located in the third quadrant. So already, now this angle will be 90 minus theta, so the remaining angle will also be theta. So if you look now very carefully, now if F1 will be acting in the third quadrant, or F1 will be lying in the third quadrant, so this angle we already know it is 90 minus theta. That is the reason why the remaining angle will be theta. So now if you look at the diagram, now what will be the total angle, or what will be the total angle between F1 and F2? You can clearly see now the total angle between F1 and F2 will be 2 theta. So this angle will be theta, this angle will be theta. So the total angle between F1 and F2 will be 2 theta. So now what I will do, I will apply the parallelogram law of vectors. So according to that, now whenever now two forces are inclined at an angle theta, or whenever now two forces are inclined to certain angle, then the resultant will be given by the diagonal of the parallelogram not drawn from the same point. So therefore, now the resultant will be given by now the diagonal of the parallelogram not drawn from the same point. So now, can anybody now tell me now what will be the net force that will be acting on the unit positive charge, or what will be the resultant force that will be acting on the unit positive charge? So you already know from the parallelogram law. Now you remember the magnitude of the resultant will be given by the formula. Now under root of a square plus b square plus 2ab cos theta. So you are already familiar from the parallelogram law, the magnitude of the resultant force will be given by the formula. So under root of a square plus b square plus 2ab cos theta. So what is A? Now A will be F1. So now remember in the given diagram, now A will be F1 and B will be F2, and the total angle between them will be 2 theta. So remember in the given diagram, our A will be F1, now B will be F2, and the total angle between them will be 2 theta. So meaning what? So if I draw the free body diagram, you can clearly see now F1 will be acting in the downward direction and F2 will be pointing in the upward direction. And you also know the total angle between them will be 2 theta. That is the reason why the resultant force will be given by, or the net force will be given by, the diagonal of the parallelogram not drawn from the same point. So from our bigger diagram, I am taking out the free body diagram. You can clearly see F1 will be acting downward, F2 will be acting upward, and the total angle between them will be 2 theta. So now the magnitude of the resultant force or the net force that will be acting on the unit positive charge will be given by the parallelogram law of vectors. So according to that, now I can write, now F net will be numerically equal to, now under root of F1 square plus F2 square plus 2 F1 F2, now multiplied by, now cos 2 theta. So remember, the angle between them will be 2 theta. So the magnitude of the net force will be given by, now under root of F1 square plus F2 square plus 2 F1 F2 cos 2 theta. So but now we already know one important thing, but we already know, so F1 will be numerically equal to F2 will be equal to F, so we already know, so F1, what the magnitude of F1 will be equal to F2 will be equal to F. Now that I will substitute in the above formula, now let us see, now what we are going to get, so after putting the value, so F net, so therefore now F net will be numerically equal to, now under root of F square plus 2 F square, now multiplied by cos 2 theta. So I can write, now under root of F square plus 2 F square, now cos 2 theta. So this can be further simplified. So if I move the free body diagram, then we can simplify further. So now I can simplify further. So therefore, now what you get, so net force will be numerically equal to, now under root of F square plus F square will become 2 F square plus the third term will be 2 F square, now multiplied by cos 2 theta. So remember, now the entire equation can be written, now under root of 2 F square plus 2 F square, now cos 2 theta. So what I can take common, so 2 F square can be taken common. So therefore, now what I can write, so the magnitude of the net force will be numerically equal to, now under root of 2x² will be permanent. Now what I get? Now 1 plus cos 2 theta. So fairly simple. Now what I am doing? Not taking 2x² common. So what I get? Now under root of 2x² now multiplied by now 1 plus cos 2 theta. So now can anybody now tell me now what will be the value of 1 plus cos 2 theta, or what will be the value of 1 plus cos 2 theta? Now remember, the YPC people, now MPC are already aware. Now remember, the YPC people. So in the trigonometry, we got a formula. So remember this formula. So remember, now 1 plus cos 2 theta will be numerically equal to 2 cos square theta. So remember this mathematical identity, or remember this trigonometrical formula. Now 1 plus cos 2 theta will be numerically equal to now 2 cos square theta. So now what I will do, I will substitute 2 cos square theta in the above formula. So therefore, the magnitude of the net force will be numerically equal to now under root of 2x² now multiplied by now we are getting now 2 cos square theta. So therefore, the magnitude of the net force will be numerically equal to, if I multiply, so what I get, now 4x² into cos square theta. So now, further, now what I will do, I will remove the terms from under root, or I will, if I remove the terms from the square root, now what further we are going to get? So if I remove the terms from the square root, now what further we are going to get? So f net will be numerically equal to, now we are going to get now 2f into cos theta. So under root of 4 will be 2f² will be equal to f under root of cos square theta will be cos theta. That is the reason why the net force that will be acting on the unit positive charge, or the net force that will be acting on the unit positive charge, will be given by the formula. So F net will be numerically equal to now 2F cos theta. Now further we can simplify. Now further we can simplify, but you already know now what is the value of f. So you already know the value of f will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now multiplied by now q divided by e square plus a square. So you already know the magnitude of f. Why? Because now you already know now f1 will be numerically equal to f2 will be equal to f. So f1 will be equal to f. Now f2 will also be equal to f. So you already know the magnitude of f will be given by the formula. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now q are divided by now d square plus a square. Now that I already know, so I can substitute in the above formula. So I already know the value of f. That is for equation number 3. So I already know the value of f. I can put. Now similarly, can anybody now tell me now what will be the value of cos theta from any one of the triangle? So I can find the value of cos theta from this triangle. Now in this triangle, this will be opposite, this will be adjacent, this will be hypotenuse. So cos theta will be defined now adjacent divided by hypotenuse, or cos theta will always be written now adjacent now divided by hypotenuse. So therefore, from this particular triangle, I can find now what will be the value of cos theta. So cos theta will be numerically equal to now adjacent now divided by hypotenuse. So cos theta should be numerically equal to now a are divided by now under root of d square plus a square. So I can say now cos theta will be numerically equal to now adjacent by hypotenuse. So you get now a are divided by now under root of d square plus a square. Now substitute both of them in the above equation. We already know f, we already know cos theta. Now substitute both of them in the equation number 3. So what we are going to get? So therefore, the magnitude of the net force will be numerically equal to now 2 multiplied by f will be now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now q are divided by now d square plus a square. So multiplied by now cos theta will be given by now a divided by, so a are divided by now under root of d square plus a square. So cos theta will be given by now a are divided by now under root of d square plus a square. So now we need to simplify. So now we don't require the diagram. So just look at the diagram. So now we don't require the diagram. Now let us simplify and let us see now what we are going to get upon simplification or after simplification. Now what will be left over? So now what I can write? So f net will be numerically equal to, now what I can do? Now first of all I can write now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. I'm rearranging all the terms, or I'm rearranging all the terms. So I can write now f net will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now multiplied by now 2a into q. So what I am doing now followed by now what I am writing now 2a q now 4 divided by in that denominator now what we got now b square plus a square now multiplied by now under root of b square plus a square. So if you remember from the previous topic, you remember now what is 2aq. So remember now 2aq will be generally called dielectric dipole moment, or 2aq will be generally called the dipole moment that will be denoted by a letter capital B. So you are already familiar from the electric dipole. Now 2aq will be generally called the dipole moment, and that will be denoted by a letter capital P. So now what I will do if I substitute, so what I am going to get, so F net will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now multiplied by now 2aq will become P now divided by now what will be denominator. Now denominator is going to become now b square plus a square now whole power 3 by 2. So remember now that denominator is going to become now b square plus a square now whole power 3 by 2. So how for the YPC people, now how we are getting the power as 3 by 2? Now very simple, now let us say you got x root x. Now let us say you got now x root x. Now this can be written now x multiplied by x power 1 by 2. So you already know when the bases are equal, or when the bases are equal, when the power should be added, that's the reason why x root x will be numerically equal to x power 1 plus 1 by 2, that will be numerically equal to now x power 3 by 2. Now remember, you need not put in that derivation, it's only for the convenience of the YPC people. So remember, now b square plus a square into under root of b square plus a square can be written by the formula. So d square plus a square now whole power 3 by 2. Now this is only for your understanding. Now do not write in the derivation. It is only for your understanding. So we got, so F net will be numerically equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now P divided by now D square plus A square now whole power 3 by 2. But remember now what we need to find, now what will be the electric field on the equatorial line, or we are supposed to find now what will be the electric field on the equatorial line. And remember by the definition, the electric field intensity will be numerically equal to the net force that will be experienced by the unit positive charge. So remember, now whatever the net force that will be experienced by the unit positive charge, or whatever the net force that will be experienced by the unit positive charge, will be generally called the electric field intensity on the equatorial line. So from the definition, I can write now equatorial will be numerically equal to the net force that will be experienced by the unit positive charge. Or always remember, not the electric field will always be defined the net force that will be experienced by the unit positive charge. So whatever the net force that will be experienced by the unit positive charge will be generally called the electric field on the equatorial line. So I can say the electric field on the equatorial line will be given by the formula. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now P divided by now D square plus A square now whole power 3 by 2. So remember, now the electric field. So remember, now the electric field on the equatorial line will be given by the formula. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now P divided by now D square plus A square now whole power 3 by 2. But remember one thing, now this will be the formula we got, or whatever formula we got, now that will be the formula we got for the electric field on the equatorial line, now due to a long dipole, or whatever the general formula we got, now that will be the formula we got for the electric field on the equatorial line, now due to a long dipole. So now we need to obtain the formula for the electric field not due to a short dipole, or the electric field not due to a shorter dipole. So once again, remember the concept. Now whatever formula we got, now this formula will be representing the electric field not due to a long dipole, or the electric field due to a longer dipole on the equatorial line. So now our job will be to find now what will be the electric field not due to a short dipole, or what will be the electric field not due to a shorter dipole. So now you are already familiar. Now what is the condition we got for the shorter dipole? So you are already familiar. Now what is the condition we got for the short dipole. So remember from my previous lecture. Now you remember from my previous lecture for short dipole. Now what is the condition we got? So remember for short dipole, now external distance will be greater than small a, or for a shorter dipole or for a smaller dipole, the external distance will be very very large when compared to small a. That's the reason why now what will happen to the denominator. So therefore the denominator can be written, now d square plus a square will be approximately equal to d square. Not bad. If I put in this formula, I'm going to get the electric field on the equatorial line, now due to a shorter dipole. Now putting now d square plus a square will be approximately equal to d square. So therefore, now what I get? So E equatorial will be numerical equal to now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now P divided by now d square plus a square will be d square now whole power 3 by 2. So 2 and 2 will be getting cancelled. That's the reason why now the electric field on the equatorial line will be given by the formula 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now P divided by EQ. So remember, now this will be the formula we got. Now this is what we want to derive. So remember, now this is the formula we got for the electric field on the equatorial line, now due to a shorter dipole. Or this is the formula we got for the electric field on the equatorial line, now due to a shorter dipole. So once you know this particular concept, so now can anybody now tell me now what will be the relation between now E axial and E equatorial? So now can anybody now tell me now what will be the relation we got now electric field on the axial line to the electric field on the equatorial line for a shorter dipole? So once again, now remember, can anybody now tell me now what will be the relation we got for the electric field on the axial line to the electric field on the equatorial line for a shorter dipole? So very very simple, now fairly simple. Now let us see. Now what is the relation we got, or what will be the relation we got between E axial and E equatorial? So now what is the relation we got, or what is the relation we got now for the electric field on the axial line to the electric field on the equatorial line for a short dipole? So you already know now the electric field on the axial line of a short dipole will be given by the formula 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now 2p divided by d cube or equation 1. Now similarly, just now we got the electric field on the equatorial line will be given by the formula 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught now p divided by d cube now called now equation number 2. Now what you do? Now divide 1 by 2. So now what you do? Now divide now equation 1 by equation 2. So what you get? So I can say now divide now 1 by 2. So therefore now E axial now divided by E equatorial will be numerically equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught 2p divided by d cube whole divided by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught p divided by d cube. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught got cancelled, p by d cube, p by d cube got cancelled. So what will be remaining? So electric field on the axial line to the electric field on the equatorial line will be numerically equal to 2. Now implies the electric field on the axial line will be 2 times the electric field on the equatorial line. So remember, now this will be the relation we got, or this will be the relation we got now between the electric field on the axial line to the electric field on the equatorial line for a short dipole. So hope girls you have understood very well. It's a very, very, very important topic we got, a very important question for 4 marks. In no material you are going to find this, maybe Narayana, maybe Chaitanya, maybe any corporate, nowhere you are going to get this simple method, what I have done on the board with the help of our parallelogram law. So we have obtained the formula, a very simple method. So what you need to do? So write down the whole thing on the white paper. Now practice a couple of times, you are definitely going to get it. So electric field on the axial line and the electric field on the equatorial line are very, very, very important questions for 4 marks. So hope all you have understood very well. Now what I want from you, your side, so please put all your comments. See, it's a kind of inspiration a lecturer will get. It's a kind of motivation we want. We got nobody in the classroom here except me and the person who's shooting. The only 2 people are there, nobody else. So I want many number of people to participate. You can participate with the help of your fingers. You need not do anything. Now sit down in your own place. Now watch out the video and put your fingers to write down the comments. So how many comments we are going to get? Now that will be a kind of inspiration for us to come daily and give our 100%, 200% or even more than that. So now remember, I am not only telling you the IP concept, but some of the concepts I am telling you are belonging to IIT. some are abstract concepts, some are neat concepts. So all you are getting in one package. What else you want? Now tell me, now which college is offering all in one? Ours is only the college which is offering everything, especially in my subject. Now if you saw my previous videos, so lecture 6 and lecture 7 is purely for upset people, for IIT people, for the neat people. I told you the applications of electric field part 1 and part 2. Now both of them are very very important for neat, for IIT mains, and for upset it will be very important. And this is the one which will be useful for IP. So everything we are giving you, what else you want? So in return, I want only one thing. I want as many number of comments you can give, not give us, so that it will be a kind of booster, it will be a kind of motivation for all of us. So that's all today, girls. Thank you. Thank you for cooperating. Thanks a lot.